والصلاه والسلام على اشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. Alhamdulillah, it's a pleasure to meet you all, some of you to meet you again, some for the first time. We've got a very limited amount of time, and so you will forgive me for rushing straight into the meat of what has brought us here. We call the subject Sharia Intelligence. It is a five-day course that we usually organize in 2 days, and which today we're going to do in just about 2 hours. And I remember a lecturer once saying, if you want to invite me to talk for 2 days, no problem. I can prepare in just 1 or 2 hours. But if you want me to talk for 1 or 2 hours, I need about 2 days to a week to prepare. And so it's really difficult to condense this topic, because it's difficult to say what's important and what's not important. So what we'll do, we'll go through as much as we can, with the understanding that this is just an introduction to the subject area. And so you will forgive me if there are certain areas that you feel we went over too quickly. At the end of it, I hope that Allah creates another opportunity where we can spend more time, go more slowly, and inshallah handle more questions. But because your questions are very important, I'd like to see if I can finish this. I understand we have from 9 till, or from now till around 11. Is that correct? So we'll try and see if we can have more than 30 minutes for Q&A. Is that enough time?
Yes.
Shana, see what we can do with that. So this is a very, underline the word very, brief introduction to the principles and the objectives of Islamic jurisprudence. Traditionally, the principles of Islamic jurisprudence deal with the foundations of Islamic jurisprudence. You've all heard of fiqh. How do you pray? How do you fast? How do you, what's the position of scholars on this and that? That's fiqh. But then when you ask a scholar, why do we do things this way? The scholar will start giving you evidence, proofs from the Quran, from the Sunnah, as to why the conclusion was reached. The study of the proofs and how these evidences are used, because that's the foundation of fiqh. Fiqh is built on what they call adilla, proofs. So the study of the use of proofs, the study of the principles, the methodology of using the Quran, the Sunnah, the study of the life of the Sahaba, and all what we will inshallah be going into, that subject area where you are studying the foundation upon which fiqh is built is called usul. So usul just actually literally means the roots. And fiqh, understanding, or jurisprudence, or some just call it law. Maqasid refers to the objectives. What's the end? What's the intent? What's it supposed to achieve? And so as we will see, there are a number of ways scholars employ to come to an understanding of what is this way of life called Sharia, or called Islam, meant to achieve. What's the final objective? Where we look at statements in the Quran, look at the Hadith, to try and understand why we are asked to eat certain things, not to eat certain things, pray, this is halal, this is haram. And scholars have come with various principles for us to, and ways of classifying what is allowed and why, what is prohibited and why. And how prohibited is something? Is it so prohibited that it is haram? Or is it just slightly prohibited that it is makruh? Or is it just okay, up to you? whether you want to eat kebab or whether you want to eat satay chicken. I work with the Da'awah Institute of Nigeria, which is the department under the Islamic Education Trust. We'll start a few steps back on the importance of good reasoning and the need for maximizing certainty. When we're talking about revelation, we're talking about seeking guidance of Allah. And we would like to be pretty clear. What is it that is the words of Allah, and what is my own input, my own understanding, which may not necessarily be in line with what did the Prophet understand? What did Allah mean? But since the Quran describes itself as an ayah and a source of guidance, and the Quran describes our reasoning as a gift from Allah that we should use in understanding revelation. And so the revelation Allah describes, both the ayat, His messages or lessons that He has given us that are in creation and in revelation. Allah asks us to study His ayat. So all the lessons we're supposed to learn, Allah describes these as being لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, for people who would use their fikra. لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ, for people who would use their minds. لِقَوْمِ لِأُولِ الْأَلْبَابِ, for people who will use their thinking faculties. Yeah, that use their brains. And look means your brain. In other words, our reasoning has a role to play when it comes to our interaction with revelation. Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali used a very interesting metaphor, and it was about the relationship between reason and revelation, and he said it was similar to the relationship between eyes and light. That for somebody to say, I am going to use my reasoning without respect for revelation, is similar to somebody saying, I am going to go around with my eyes open in the dark. And for somebody to say, I am going to use revelation but not reasoning, is similar to somebody moving around in the daytime but with their eyes closed, you know, with their eyes shut. And so we need to recognize both reasoning and revelation as gifts from Allah that we use in the search for the will of Allah. The will of Allah has been sent down to us through revelation. Reasoning plays some critical roles here. Number one, verification of the authenticity of revelation. How are you sure the Quran is the word of Allah? How are you sure that the Prophet ﷺ said what he said? These are not areas of aqidah. Is it understood? You don't just believe the Prophet said something. So scholars who study this area, if you can bring enough reasons, and we'll look at very briefly some of the criteria, if you can bring enough reasons to prove that this was not the words of the Prophet ﷺ, they will take it. They are ready to assess the facts. They're ready to look at the evidence again. Is this hadith strong or weak? Scholars will debate it. Why? It's not that they are following a hadith and whether it's right or wrong, we love the Prophet. No, they want to be first sure. Is it from the Prophet? Is it authentic? And they look at various things. We won't spend much time on this. But it's a little similar to a prescription from a doctor. Like, once you are sure it's from the doctor, then you follow. Why? You agree the doctor knows more about your health than you do. Okay? If the doctor says stop eating this, you'll stop eating. If the doctor says you have an operation, okay, no problem. Like, you know my situation better. You trust the doctor. It's not blind faith. But you have to be sure that the prescription is from the doctor. So the job of reasoning, one job is to verify, did this prescription come from the doctor? That you can reason out. And the doctor doesn't get angry with you because you are wanting to be sure, is it really from you, is it really for me, or is this somebody else's prescription? So reasoning has a role to play there. Another role reasoning has to play is in understanding the meaning and the implications of revelation. The meaning and implications of revelation. An important point I should not forget is, under the first area, this verification of authenticity, if you wanted to be sure some information is authentic, and the information, somebody says, Socrates said something, Aristotle said something, Shakespeare said something. Now these people were long dead, you know, long gone. How are you going to verify if that was true? You're not there. So what is the mechanism that you would use to ascertain whether these people actually said so or not? This is the subject that scholars who study ulum al-hadith go into, the sciences of hadith. And they're looking basically at four things. They want to know, firstly, is there a chain of narrators? When you say the sister at the back said something, how did that information get to us? So where did we get this information from? How did you get it from her? Where did she get it from? So they want to make sure there's an unbroken chain to the source of information. That's number one. But then the people in the chain, are they trustworthy or not? That's the second question. So they also study what they call ilm al-rijal, the biographies of each individual in the chain. Yes, people are innocent until proven guilty, but are you actually innocent? Are you known to have lied? Are you known to be a trustworthy person? So that's another thing they're interested in, the credibility and reliability. Another thing they're interested in is the fact that, yes, this is a reliable chain of narrators, but they're still human. They could have made a mistake. So do we have, apart from this chain, another independent chain of narrators saying the same thing? And another independent chain of narrators saying the same thing? If we only have one chain, they call such a hadith, Garib hadith, sole narrator. Nobody else knew about this, but this chain, where they get two chains, they call it Aziz. Where they have three chains, they say it's Mashhur. But whether it's one chain, two chain, three chains, they still call all those hadith, Ahad hadith. It is equivalent, effectively, to one. Why? Because you could still have corruption. You could still have mistakes. But the moment the number of chains are sufficiently independent and sufficiently many to remove the doubt that there was any possibility of error, the moment they have sufficient independent hadith, they say those hadith are mutawatir. And now it has removed the doubt, they are now certain. Another area they are concerned about is the contents of the hadith. What is the hadith saying? Does it contradict anything? And the other hadith that are stronger, does it contradict something from the Quran? So they therefore need a continuous linked chain, reliable narrators, independent chains, and they look at the contents of the hadith, whether it's corroborated with any other evidence, or whether it contradicts something that is stronger. And this would apply to any other field where you are trying to ask yourself, is it reliable or not? Here, it is where you say to yourself, if you have verified the information that this is reliable, this is the words of Allah from the Prophet, and the whole of Quran is mutawatir. Yeah. there are just so many people who had memorized it, who had written it from the dictation of the Prophet. And the hadith, we have some that are mutawatir, others are not. But even after you have said, you've got authentic information, you've got the prescription from the doctor, but what does it mean? Do you understand it? Does it make sense? And so you have people who specialize in understanding the meanings of the hadith, studying the context. What did it say? How was it understood by the Prophet or the Sahaba? And so you find books on the sharh of hadith, the explanation of hadith. So Imam al-Nawawi did an explanation of Sahih Muslim. Ibn Hajar did an explanation of Sahih Bukhari. And many others did explanations of these. In other words, they look at all the various hadith related to the topic to try and explain this hadith. Why? Because they have various chains throughout the same hadith, and some chains give a little bit more information than another chain. One chain gave us a bit more information about the context. Another chain just told us what was said. So by studying all of these, so you find many chains of narrators, they are able to give a better explanation of this hadith. Those who look into the meaning of the Quran, what do you call those people? Mufassirun, good, a mufassir. And what they do, tafsir, right? So they are trying to understand the meaning of the Quranic verses. But you find people who, they also want to know the wisdom behind revelation. They're interested in the wisdom behind the revelation. Okay, yes, the Quran and the Sunnah did not say anything about cocaine. But by studying the wisdom behind the prohibition of cocaine, you understand the problem is intoxication. So once you know that's the wisdom behind this, it gives us the wisdom to handle new types of intoxicants. And what do we do about new cases? There was no e-commerce, now there is. Which laws do we apply to cyber crimes? Or should we say, since it's not in the Quran, it's not the Sunnah, forget about it? So they're interested in the wisdom. And the study of the wisdom behind revelation is called the maqasid. Then you've got the application of revelation. The application of revelation. Yes, the Quran says, alcohol is prohibited. But what of a situation where alcohol is part of a medicine and your illness is potentially fatal? How do we apply the revelation in that context? It says we should not eat pork. In fact, literally, it says lahm al-khinzir, the flesh of pork. What about pork gelatin? Is that haram? Is that what the Quran spoke about? What about the skin of a pig? Is that what the Quran spoke about? So when it comes to the application of statements in the Quran, what are the guidelines for application? Is it okay to say that grape juice is halal? Are we all okay with that? When grape juice is converted to wine, it becomes haram. Are we okay with that?
Yes.
When wine is converted to vinegar, it becomes halal. Are we okay with that?
Yes.
For some, they're not too comfortable with that. For others, the moment it is no more the original material, the moment it no more has the same properties, they call that process istihala. It has transformed into something else. So the verdict of Allah on grape juice does not apply to wine. Wine has different qualities. The verdict on wine does not apply to vinegar, different qualities. But they would take it further. And for some, the verdict on pork does not apply to gelatin. The verdict on the animal that is haram to consume does not apply to the skin of the animal once it's been tanned. Musk, which is a perfume, you know where it comes from?
Deer.
What part of the deer? Sorry?
Blood?
Urine?
Blood.
It's part of its feces. Okay. But if you get feces, is that najasa?
Yes.
And you put it beside your tomato, and your tomato is nice red and big, is that halal to consume? If you recycle water that came from toilet, is it clean? Alright, if God recycles water, is it clean?
Yes.
I mean, that's what rainfall is, right? It's recycled water. So, scholars delve into this. We will not be going into each one of these. But this is where scholars are trying to look at what do they take from Quran and Sunnah, and with what level of certainty can they apply it elsewhere and still say that is Allah's position, as opposed to that's what I, the scholar, think. So reasoning still plays a role in each one of these, and also certain rules that go with the roles of reasoning in each of these. But generally this subject area of application and the wisdom and the meaning, these three areas are joined together in the subject of usul al-fiqh. That when you pick a book on usul al-fiqh, you're going to be studying these areas. You will usually not be studying the verification of authenticity. That's another subject. But it is important to remember that authenticity is insufficient for truth. Because information is authentic, doesn't automatically mean you've got the truth if you took one meaning and it could have meant something else. Okay? So just because something is authentic doesn't mean the meaning is clear. Let's look at an example about the kufr toilet and the Muslim kafir. Sounds like an oxymoron. But you've heard some Muslims being called kufar. And somebody says, well, there's an ayah in the Quran which proves that if you use the toilet, you are a kafir. The moment you flush. And he says, yes. Why? Because you could have urinated outside and cleaned yourself with just a cup of water. Instead, you flushed 20 liters of clean, drinkable water. That is wastefulness. And Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْمُبَزِّرِينَ Those who are wasteful, كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ are the brothers of shaitan, وَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانِ إِلَى رَبِّهِ كَفُورًا And shaitan is to his Lord a kafir. Therefore, you are a brother of shaitan. And if shaitan is a kafir, the brother of shaitan will be what? A kafir too. But if you think the Quran is not clear enough, let's go to a hadith where the Prophet said, Man tashabbaha biqaumin fahuwa minhum. Whoever imitates a people is one of them. This water-wasting kufr technology, you copied it from whom? So we copied it from the kufar. Good. Whoever copies a people is one of them. And what's the point here? You can quote Quran, you can quote Sunnah, you can come with all sorts of crazy understandings. It's not that the Quran is the verse authentic or not. No, it's what did it mean? Is that how the Prophet and the Sahaba understood it? Or are you reading into the text? you find some Muslims saying, oh, there's an ayah of the Quran, مَنْ لَا يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Whoever does not judge by what Allah has revealed is a kafir. Therefore, if you catch a thief and you don't implement the had, you are a kafir. You drink alcohol? Said yes. And you know Allah has made it haram? Yes. So you are a kafir. Because you judge something, you have made it halal for yourself. Allah has made it haram. If you contradict the lawgiver, you're a kafir. Which means anybody who commits any sin, you still you're a kafir. And so you find, back in Nigeria, groups like Boko Haram, you find all sorts of groups within the Muslim world, from the time of the Sahaba, the Khawarij, people who justified all sorts of atrocities in the name and with the logic that you did something wrong means you disobeyed Allah, and Allah says whoever judges by something other than what Allah has revealed is a kafir, so you're a kafir. And because something is authentic, but people could derive wrong meanings, it became important for us to have methodology. For us to have scholars who are called mujtahids, who would involve in ijtihad. And ijtihad basically means all the effort to do with reasoning, the getting of evidence, to handle an Islamic position where the Quran or Sunnah are not clear, or not explicit, or where the Quran and Sunnah is silent. Or where the Quran and Sunnah is clear, but the context is different. So, when somebody says, oh, if you, whoever is wasteful is one of the brothers of Shaitan, and therefore, step by step, they say you are a kafir, somebody asks, wait a minute, but Allah says He will send to the people of Lut, their brother. And He will send to these people their brother, the people of Thamud or Ad, their brother Saleh, or their brother this. Because he was brothers and they were kuffar, does that mean the Prophet was a kafir? Said no. So when he says you are brother, it's just associating you with you, it's not giving you the same judgment as them. And you say whoever imitates the people is one of them. Yes, but the Sahaba learnt languages of other people. But the Prophet sometimes would dress like a Yemeni or a Persian. Does that mean he was also a kafir? No. So when you say whoever imitates the people is one of them, what exactly does that mean? When somebody says, whoever doesn't judge by what Allah has revealed is a kafir, what does that mean? You need to distinguish between somebody who drinks alcohol and you say, you're drinking alcohol? Yes. Why? And the person says, well, you know, it's a bit difficult these days, you know, I get very tired, the influence of friends. Do you know it is haram? He says, yes, I know it's haram, but you know. So he has given alcohol the judgment of Allah. He's a Muslim. He's just telling you he is weak and cannot follow that. You call such a person, if you were to call him anything, you'd say he's a fasik, he's doing something wrong. He's not a kafir. He doesn't take an imam of Islam. But unless you follow the methodology of interpretation, you can pick verses of Quran and Hadith and do nearly anything you want with them. Forget the context. Forget other verses that handle the topic. Forget whether that's how the Prophet and the Sahaba understood the topics. So we'll spend some time, inshallah, on this question of methodology. But the thing of a mujtahid was to try and represent the Prophet in his absence. That was the big job of a mujtahid. This was a scholar who didn't just want to know, excuse me, is this hadith authentic or whatever? That's for other scholars to do. Muhaddithun would handle the authenticity of hadith. But when it came to the scholar, what to do? The mujtahid was really trying to answer the question, what would the Prophet do in this situation? Would the Prophet allow stem cell research? Would the Prophet allow cloning of animals or cloning of people? Would he allow somebody to change their sex? Would he allow additives in food that came from haram sources but that are transformed from their original form? What would the Prophet do in this situation? And this was a tough question. How do you step into the shoes of a prophet? Really, you can't. But you have to say something. People want to know what is the guidance. And so what these scholars do is looking at the way the Prophet handled issues, looking at the way the caliphs and the Sahaba after him handled issues, they derive principles of methodology that will guide them in what to do in new situations. In science, you have what they call the scientific method. And if you're doing a first degree or a master's degree or a PhD, one of the things you will have to explain is your materials and methods, right? Yeah, you have to say what's the material, you have to say your method. If there's a mistake with your method, then most likely your final answer is going to be wrong. If your method is sound, then usually we would have to accept your conclusion. And if it's a very new conclusion, and it's a contribution to knowledge, they say, fine, you've got a PhD in that area. But methodology matters. Which type of randomized design do you use? How big is your sample size before you say this represents KL, or this represents anything? What statistical tool do you use in assessing your results? Do you use an analysis of variance? How do you analyze? You can't just come with anything you want. There are experts in the field who would tell you this is how to go about that analysis on that subject area. So those scholars who are interested in qualifying to represent the Prophet ﷺ in his absence were described as mujtahids. These were people who had the highest qualifications among all scholars. Yeah. The mujtahid was higher than the mufassir, higher than everybody else. Because he had to understand not just the letter, but the spirit of the law. He had to know what most likely would the Prophet have done in a new situation. What would the Sunnah have been if Umar was still alive? One major objective of all this methodology is to be able to classify things based on the level of desirability or undesirability. They were concerned that there's a sin attached to speaking in God's name. So they wanted to be certain, if you are going to say Allah says, or if you're going to say there's a sin for this, and you could have two types of sins, a sin for commission or a sin for omission. What do you call something that is a sin if you commit it?
Haram.
Sorry?
Haram.
Haram, very good. Haram means there's a sin if you commit it. What do you call something where there's a sin if you omit it?
Wajib.
Wajib, good. Or fard. Fard means it's compulsory and if you don't do it, there's a sin. But who puts a sin on things? You? No. You need evidence from the Quran or the Sunnah that Allah will put a sin on something. And that is why if you're going to say something is fard or wajib, or if you're going to say something is haram, you can't just, I think, I don't like it. No. Why? You're talking in a territory that belongs to Allah. And so the scholars classified things into five major categories. Fard or wajib, which meant it was compulsory. Sinful if omitted. Mustahab or mandub was not compulsory, but it was encouraged. It was good. You even have a reward for doing it, but no sin if you don't do it. Like what? Nawafil prayers, good. Sadaqah. Okay. While zakat would be wajib, sadaqah would be mustahab or mandub. What would be a third category? Makruh. Okay. That's true. Anything else? What would be less? We're going from fard to haram.
Mubah.
Mubah. Very good. So mubah, also called jahiz, means permissible. Neither encouraged nor discouraged. So it's whether you want to eat bread or rice, whether you want to do this or that, whether you want to dress in this color or that color, whether you want to move on a bicycle or motorcycle, whether, up to you. Most of the things in Sharia belong to mubah category. It's the general the assumption behind all things is they are permissible.
Is mubah same with harus? Sorry.
Same with?
Harus. Is it harus in Arabic? Harus? No.
Malay word?
Malay word. Okay.
Sorry. It's the same thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Neither
Neither discouraged nor discouraged. Yeah. So Sharia has a neutral position on that. Makruh? Discouraged, disliked, but tolerated. And the last one? Haram. Forbidden or prohibited, sinful if committed. This section on the middle is mubah, but your intention for doing it could raise it up or bring it down. So do you want to buy tomatoes from the big shop or from the little roadside seller? It's all mubah from the Sharia perspective. But then you feel, I'd like to economically help the weaker one. So I'll go and buy from him, even though his tomatoes may not be as clean as the other one, but it's just to give him another source of income. I can wash the tomatoes at home. Your intention made something that was mubah, something that was rewarded. But from a clear objective point of view, it's up to you. Abu Hanifa, and in the Hanafi school of thought, they felt that this classification into five was not nuanced enough, did not sufficiently capture the variety of desirables and undesirables. So they classified things into seven categories, not five. The Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali stuck to five. What the Hanafis did is, they distinguished between fard and wajib. So in the Hanafi school, fard is when something is compulsory, obligatory, sinful if committed, and certain without doubt. Okay? When you say certain without doubt, what do you mean? To them, it means that the prohibition comes from Quran or from Sunnah Mutawatir, not from anything else. So for Hanafi, fard means there is full certainty. But if you say something is haram based on a single chain hadith, the Hanafis will say that's just wajib. Sorry, if you say it's compulsory based on a single chain hadith, they will say wajib. So they distinguish between fard and wajib. This is more serious than this. On the area of makruh, they have makruh like everybody else, but they call this makruh tanzihi. Then they have another kind of makruh that is in between makruh and haram. They call makruh tahrimi. Makruh tahrimi is the opposite of wajib. Makruh tahrimi is something that is haram based on a single chain hadith. or where there is insufficient evidence for the Hanafi scholar to feel completely certain that this is haram. So for that, they would distinguish between haram, which comes from the Quran and Sunnah mutawatir, that is explicitly clear, and certain, what they call adilla qat'i. That is where the authenticity is certain, no doubt about it, and the meaning is certain, no doubt about it. So where they call, they describe such type of thing as qat'i thubut or qat'i wurud. In other words, there is certainty regarding the authenticity, but also qat'i dilala, that in the meaning and the implication, there's certainty there too. So where there's full certainty, they're ready to say, use the word fard or haram. Where there's anything less than that, then they would use other vocabulary. Whereas all the other scholars felt, no, fard and wajib, in other words, five is enough. Hanafis felt seven. Some Hanafis actually moved to 11 categories. I like fishing. Okay. Yes, please.
For other imam, then yes. Hanafi. For far and haram, other hadith ahad can go in these categories or not? For far and haram.
For the Shafi and for the Hanbali, ahad hadith can make a thing haram or wajib. Can make haram, it can make fard or wajib. Shafi and Hanbali. For Maliki, there are two positions. Ahad hadith, like for Maliki and arguments by Imam Shafi'i, for Maliki, an ahad hadith can only make the thing mustahab or makruh, not haram. So in Maliki, for example, because you have a hadith that is sahih, it's authentic, which the Prophet said, you should not eat birds of prey, birds that have claws or talons, and you should not eat animals that have canine teeth, carnivorous animals. Okay. But that is a single chain hadith. So because it's a single chain hadith, Malikis do not treat it as haram. Yeah. For the Malikis, it will only be makruh. If a dog licks a bowl, the hadith says wash it seven times, and one of those times with sand. But it's an ahad hadith. And so for the Malikis, because that ahad hadith does not have backing, the thinking of the Malikis, and we'll come back to this a little later, the thinking of the Malikis is eating of carnivorous animals or not eating of carnivorous animals should be common knowledge for everybody. And what to do when a dog licks your bowl should be common knowledge. So on those things that should be common knowledge, but you only have single chain hadith, ahad hadith narrating it, it makes them doubt. So they don't want to say haram just because of a single chain hadith. So Maliki usually put another condition, which we will come to later, where they also look at what is called the Amal Ahl al-Madina. Did the people of Medina, after the time of the Prophet, also consider it haram? If no evidence, then they say that hadith is shaz. Shaz means they don't know, it means it's ambiguous, they don't know how to apply it. But they're not going to make haram because of uncertainty. Because to the Maliki, if something was haram, then the Prophet would have made sure it was haram. And people from Medina would have learned it was haram from the Prophet. And after the Prophet died, if it was haram and people of Medina did not know it was haram, Abu Bakr would have made it clear it was haram because he was a caliph. And if Abu Bakr did not make it haram, then during the time of Umar, Umar would have made sure everybody knew it was haram. And he was a caliph for about 10 years. And if after Umar, nobody knew it was haram, then during the time of Uthman, who was there for about 12 years, he would have made it clear it was haram. And he changed the capital. So if all these people seem to be unaware that it was haram, and there was no policy on the ground that it was haram, for Malik, that itself is a reason to suspect such hadith. We'll come back to that later. Fishing. If you want to catch a shark, what kind of fishing rod do you need? Big one. Strong one?
Yes.
What kind of hook?
Big one.
It's a cage.
Depends on the size of the shark, right? And the line and the bait. In other words, once you know the kind of fish you are going to get, it will dictate to you what kind of tackle you're going to put together. When a mujtahid wants to understand what would the sunnah be, he's like fishing for the sunnah. There are certain things that mujtahid would want to qualify in and get. What the mujtahid is trying to do is fishing for the sunnah always and everywhere. In every circumstance, the mujtahid wants to know what would the sunnah be in this situation. It's either you have it happened before, or you take a calculated guess. Calculated, not just off the top of your head. And how do they do that? They have certain tackle, certain tools that they use. Now, in the area of specialization, yes, a fisherman would need a fishing rod, line, reel, hook, float, all these things. And he would decide what type of line to get. You may be a specialist in making line, it doesn't mean you know how to catch fish. You may be a specialist in making hooks, it doesn't mean you know how to catch a shark. So you may be a specialist in hadith authenticity. You may be a specialist in tafsir. You may be a specialist in Arabic. Not modern Arabic, Arabic as was understood during the time of the revelation of the Quran. For us today, kitab means book. Kataba means write. So we say Ahl al-Kitab, people of the book. But the Quran was described, وَأَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ, and we sent down to you the kitab. But no book flew down from heaven. So what does kitab mean? Okay, revelation. So some would therefore say Ahl al-Kitab means people of an earlier revelation, whether it was book or not a book form. So you've got various specializations that get together, and the mujtahid is the one who knows what to take from each one. There are certain tools that help the mujtahid in representing the sunnah. Remember, this is what the mujtahid is looking for. How to represent the Prophet ﷺ in his absence. What would the sunnah be for doctors and dentists and engineers today? Would the Prophet have been concerned about pollution? Would he have been concerned about that? Would he have been concerned about shark fin soup? Or would he just not worry about it? Would he have been concerned about chickens being kept in cages where they can't flap their wings? Or he wouldn't have minded? Would he have been concerned about deforestation? Would he have been concerned about the type of weapons we develop for war? Weapons that don't distinguish between who's fighting and who's not fighting. So the mujtahid is trying to ask himself, in every situation, always, everywhere, what would the sunnah have been? By studying what it was, the Prophet said, follow my sunnah and the sunnah of my rightly guided companions or successors. So that's what they tried to do. To try and get the sunnah by studying a number of tools. The Prophet was described as being like a walking Quran. So scholars understand, we must get the Quran because the Quran is the guidance that even the Prophet was following. He was the practical implication of that sunnah. They want to look at hadith to get the sunnah. What's the difference between hadith and sunnah? Difference between hadith and sunnah. Not the spelling. Hadith is a narration, and from that narration we get to understand what was the tradition and practice of the Prophet. Okay? So hadith is a carrier of the sunnah. A carrier, not the only carrier. And so for some, they wanted to know, was there a consensus, for example, among the Sahaba? For Imam Shafi and Maliki and Hanafi, if there was an ijma', there was a consensus among the Sahaba on a particular issue, and it contradicted a single chain hadith, they felt that the ijma' of Sahaba was more reliable as representing the sunnah than a single chain hadith. Is it understood? Yeah. Remember what the mujtahid wants is, I want to follow Quran and Sunnah. For the Maliki scholars, they felt that a single chain hadith was not as reliable as the tradition of the people of Medina. So if, for example, you had a narration regarding the call for prayer, adhan, and you had two hadith. It was recited this way, it was recited another way. Which one would Maliki scholars or Imam Malik consider as the most reliable form of adhan? He asks himself, what do you think he would ask himself?
Which is the amal of?
Good, which is the amal. The Imam Malik's teachers were students of the Sahaba. Okay? Imam Malik's teachers were students of the Sahaba.
Tabi'in, you mean?
Sorry?
Student of Sahaba means Tabi'in.
Yes, his teachers were Tabi'in. Okay. Exactly. So, if there was a way in which Adhan was being called at the time of the Prophet, and that was passed to the Sahaba, and every day, five times, there was an adhan to one generation, to the generation of his teachers, which he saw being done in Medina. He takes that as having come down by a more reliable chain. That to him is more representative of the sunnah than a single chain hadith. So for him, any hadith that is in line with Amal of Medina is far superior to a single chain hadith. And any hadith that contradicts Amal, to him, must have something wrong with it. Especially if the chain of hadith did not originate from Medina. You know, when you look at the chain of narrators, because most of the Sahaba died in Medina. A few went out. Okay. That's where the caliphs were. Abu Bakr, Uthman, that's where knowledge moved to other places, not the other way around. And so to Malik, if you have a hadith and there's no chain in Medina, he questions it. Amal of Medina knows nothing about it, yeah. He considers it as shaz. Some later Malikis would just give it the strength to make makruh or mustahab, but not haram or fard.
Sheikh, How about Abu Hanifa? Abu Hanifa is earlier than Malik, right?
Yes.
So, did he learn from Tabi'in?
Yes.
Also, but yes, he didn't have the opinion that Amal of Medina is superior.
No, because in places like Kufa, in Egypt, in Syria, in these places, you had a few Sahaba who went there. In Medina, that was headquarters. So Medinan practice had been fashioned by the fact that the Prophet lived there and the caliphs, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, lived there. Whereas because a few went to other places, it wasn't enough to change the culture of that environment. So for Malik, he could trust the Amal of Medina, but others didn't feel they could trust the Amal of their place. Why? Because the culture was not a product of the time of the Prophet and the Sahaba there. Yeah. So Hanafi, Shafi, who was a student of Malik and later Hanbali, did not go with Amal of Medina. But Abu Yusuf and some of the Hanbali scholars like Ibn Taymiyyah did give respect to Amal of Medina. But when you say as a madhab, it was a Maliki thing. Yeah. In this subject, when we say according to the Malikis, it doesn't mean there's no individual Shafi or Hanbali or somebody else who also takes that. When we say the Shafi position is this, you'd usually get a Maliki and a this and an individual who also goes with that. But the dominant position of the school is what we're talking about. So another thing they would use is qiyas, analogy. Analogy. By trying to understand why something was prohibited, they can now extend the law to a new case. Urf, custom. Local custom. What they notice is, the Prophet ﷺ saw so many things being done in the Jahiliyyah community that did not contradict the Sharia. Okay? And he practiced them. Because he practiced them, we call these things sunnah, because it's among the things the Prophet did. But it's not that he invented them. You know, in Islamic finance, when you hear of ijara and murabaha and mudaraba and istisnan, various financial tools, musharaka, etc., these were financial tools that were already in use during Jahiliyyah. Okay? You didn't have to, people were already doing business long before. Trade was already going on. How the Meccans dressed. If you're a leader in Mecca, you move around with a stick. You don't stand in front of a congregation without holding a stick. So you find in some places the Jummah Imam will hold a stick. Okay. For other madhabs, this is just part of the urf, the custom. It wasn't a sunnah that had to be copied. So, urf or custom, you know, Allah talks about how in Hujarat, in the Quran, He has created nations and tribes that you should recognize one another. Okay, that our various languages are part of the ayat of Allah. And for Sharia, culture gives people an identity. It gives them a language. It gives them social order. And if a part of a culture does not contradict Sharia, the fact that it creates greater social order is something that is supported by Sharia. And so they actually have al-ada muhakkama, or urf muhakkama, that culture is a source of law in Sharia. If you say something in Malay you are using ringgits, Sharia recognizes ringgits as your urf, your means of transactions. You don't have to say it has to be dinar and dirham because that's what the Prophet used. Because they were using dinar and dirham even before the Prophet. So this is a very large and very interesting area, particularly when you're dealing with converts. Because the tendency is, we want you to change your name to a Muslim name. You're changing his name to an Arab name. The Prophet didn't change his name. Abu Bakr didn't change his name, Aisha didn't change her name, Khalid didn't change. There's nothing wrong, it's urf, it's custom. careful when you mix it with religion, or you think an urf is a part of the teaching of the religion, and then you want to transfer that. Then you, Islam has to get excess baggage. You know, it starts becoming more difficult for people to accept. Because they're not just having to apostatize, change religion, but also cultural apostasy. People are proud of their religion. So it's important to really think carefully, particularly if you're a Muslim majority. Like where I come from, and to some extent, I think even here in Malaysia. Where I come from, the Hausa tribe is the Nupe tribe. Most of us are Muslims. And when somebody becomes a Muslim, we want him to change his name, his dressing, his everything. To dress like us, when our dressing is just one cultural expression of dressing that Islam is okay with, but that's not the only thing Islam is okay with. There are other styles of dressing that have met Islamic requirements. There are other names that have met Islamic requirements. If you listen to the meaning of some of the Arab names, very funny names. But they're fine, you know. Somebody's name is Asad, means a lion. Somebody's name is Khidr, just means green. Mr. Brown and Mr. Black. Ghazali means what? Yeah, it's a deer, kind of an antelope. Abu Huraira, owner of a kitten, yeah. Etc. Jamal, camel. Then you had the Ra'i of Sahaba, the opinions of Sahaba. If the Sahaba thought something was bad, then many mujtahids would feel, we would also not feel comfortable with it. Why? Because probably they are not comfortable with it because of something they knew from the Prophet. So even though you don't have a hadith, but this was the position of the Sahaba, some scholars would feel comfortable relying on the Sahaba. Other scholars, some of the Zahiri scholars, some of the Hanbali scholars like Ibn Taymiyyah, Shawkani, number of other scholars, would feel, you know what, we go with Quran and we go with Sunnah that we can get from Hadith. Ra'i of Sahaba is just Ra'i of Sahaba. Yeah. Prophet said, hold on to two things, Quran and Sunnah. So we'll just hold on to that. Others feel, yes, but where do you get the Sunnah from? So that's an area where you start seeing how the equations or the tools that are used differ. So just as we said with the fishing thing, if you change hook, if you change line, and you use a weaker line, you will not catch a shark. You'll catch something smaller. So once you change tools, once you change the equations you're going to use, the results follow. Now, these tools are important, but the scholars were also interested in safety nets. Because after what the Quran and Sunnah are clear about, when you say ijma, consensus, what exactly is this? It means the Quran and Sunnah are silent and you're going with a consensus. But then if you're going with a consensus that is not based on Quran and Sunnah, then it is their own ijtihad. And some felt Amal of Medina was just making Islam very regional. It allowed those sunnah that were part of the urf of Medina to be respected more than other sunnah that Sahaba spread elsewhere that were also credible. Custom, qiyas, opinion of Sahaba. For some, in the moment you start going outside Quran and Sunnah, you're going into ijma, amal, qiyas, etc., you will start creating some problems. So for example, in the Maliki school, the example we raised earlier on, where for some, if a dog licks a bowl, the bowl should be washed 7 times and one of those times with sand, Maliki feels a number of things about that hadith. For the Hanbali and the Shafi, they feel that dog licking bowl, you have to pour the contents out, you have to wash it 7 times, means that dog saliva is najasa. It's impure. Okay? And since it is impure, if a dog licks your hand, it is similar to you having urine or feces on your hand. You can't go and pray with it. Did the Prophet say dog saliva is najasa?
No.
Did he? No, he didn't. He just says when a bowl is licked by a dog, you wash it. The conclusion is, because it is najasa. That's qiyas. You're saying, this is for this reason, therefore, you come with a new reasoning. The Malikis take objection. They look at it and say, but that's going to create a lot of problem for people. A lot of inconvenience. And it's an Ahad Hadith. But Malik looks into the activities of Sahaba and the Amal of Medina, and he finds there that some of the Sahaba ate a hyena. A hyena is a carnivorous animal. And because of that, actually another more important reason is the Quran says when you have your hunting dogs and you release them and they go and catch the animal, you are allowed to eat that animal. But sometimes when a hunting dog catches an animal, it's with the animal for some time before it finally, you get it. How much saliva has been on that animal? And there's nothing in the hadith about washing the animal. So Maliki looks at it as this qiyas is wrong. You cannot conclude that because you should wash a bowl 7 times means it is najasa, which means it affects your ablution. So you have the concern for what they call juristic preference or equity or just juristic discretion called istihsan, which was accepted by Maliki and the Hanafi. It was accepted later on by the Shafi'i school, particularly after scholars like Imam al-Juwayni and Imam al-Ghazali. They had a concept of maslaha, public interest, where certain things would be permitted or prohibited because there was a concern for maqasid, the objectives of Sharia. So even though the Quran is the one that says you cut the hand of a thief, but during a period of food shortage, a lot of the people who were stealing were poor people. Umar, when he was caliph, suspended the punishment for cutting hands. Why would he suspend a clear statement of the Quran? Because he could see that that was not going to achieve justice. It wasn't going to achieve the objectives of Sharia. So the use of juristic preference or public interest, these are what are called istihsan for juristic preference, public interest, maslaha, or sadd daraya, blocking the means. So people, for example, would go outside Medina to others who were bringing goods from the villages and surrounding areas, and these people would go and meet these others before they got into the city, buy the goods from them, then come and sell them in the city at very high prices. Okay? They were middlemen that were not adding any value. The middlemen could say, I'm just doing trade. It's just business. It's not haram. Where you have something that is halal, but it is leading to hardship, even though there's no prohibition from the Quran or Sunnah for that, Umar prohibited it. Umar prohibited it. Why? And that type of reasoning is called sadd daraya. Okay? It's you block the means to something that is haram. So this concern for maqasid became like a compass. These usul tools, all of them were considered tools of usul al-fiqh, but the concern for the consequences, the harm or benefit, became something that balanced qiyas and the application of these tools. So what you had in the end was, this is just a recap of some of what we've discussed. If this was a tree, at the bottom of the roots is where you have the Quran and the Sunnah, which is the source of guidance. They use usulul fiqh and these tools of ijtihad. And from there, they come out with the fruit, or what you call a fatwa. Quran and Sunnah, divine origin, generally called Sharia. This intellectual effort of ijtihad is what puts the human element into fatwa. The person who gives a fatwa is called a mufti. The person who does ijtihad is called a mujtahid. Those who look at the raw materials, the pure ingredients from the Quran and Sunnah are mufassirun, scholars of tafsir or scholars of ulumul hadith, who study the hadith sciences. If we take a metaphor from the health sciences, these are dealing with the raw ingredients, the minerals, the active ingredients that go into producing the medicines. The industrial pharmacist is the person who makes the medicine. But like malaria, you can have many different medicines for malaria. Some malaria medicines don't work on certain strains of malaria. So you can have different medicines that have been produced by the industrial pharmacists. The job of the doctor is to decide which of these medicine applies to his patient. The faqih is the person who gathers, he's like the person who works in the chemist, you know, your clinical pharmacist, the person who keeps all the medicines there. And when you say, so the doctor wants the medicine, he tells you get this. But the pharmacist or the chemist may not be good at diagnosing and prescribing. So a faqih is not automatically a mufti. But the critical point is, while here you can say Allah said and the Prophet said, by the time it has gone through the industrial pharmacist, there's a level of speculation that has been added. And a mufti, just like a doctor, is giving an answer to a particular question in a particular context. Fruits change as seasons change. Some are ripe, some are raw, some are rotten. Some belong to a previous time. And so the job of the doctor is to keep diagnosing. The job of the mufti is to keep diagnosing. You can't outsource muftis. Muftis have to be people who know the context, and they are able to give fatwa relevant to the problem. Where, we'll come back to this later, on the difference between the hukum and fatwa. As we said earlier on, scholars are careful about speaking in God's name. So one area they want so they are certain and don't say what Allah has not given authority to say is they're concerned about authenticity. They're concerned about the meaning. Whose meaning? Is that what they are understanding out of possible meanings? Or is that the understanding of the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba? But also they are very concerned about the implications of the Sunnah. When you say, the Prophet said, the Prophet did, does that automatically mean you should say and you should do? Okay? So it's a big question. And some scholars looked very carefully at the Sunnah. And they classified the Sunnah initially into two broad categories. Sunnah that was tashri, which was Sunnah that was legally binding on us to follow, and the Sunnah that was ghayra tashri, it was not legally binding. And so other scholars reclassified the role of the Prophet into 3, into 4, into 7, into 12 or more categories. What do we mean? There are things the Prophet would say or do in his capacity as a messenger of God to mankind. And everybody was supposed to follow that Sunnah. So when the Prophet says, pray as you see me praying, he's talking to everybody. And so we all do our best to pray the way the Prophet prayed. Where he says, take your rites of Hajj, how to perform Hajj, from me. In other words, by observing him, we try to perform Hajj the way the Prophet did it. So in those things that the Prophet did in his capacity as a Prophet, we as submitters to the will of Allah, follow that example. Prophet did it, we will do it. Prophet said this, we will say that. But then there were certain things the Prophet ﷺ did in his capacity as a political leader, as a head of state, as a commander-in-chief of the armed forces. He would decide who to have treaties with, who to fight, where to send armies, who to appoint as a governor. You don't say today or any other time that since the Prophet did it, I can do it. That I will declare war between here and there. I am going to make treaties with any other country. I will decide who is going to be the governor of this state or that state. Why? The Prophet did it, it's sunnah, I will do it too. No, that is a sunnah only if you are a head of state. There are certain things the Prophet ﷺ did in his capacity as a judge. As a judge, you have the right to say, punish this person for this offense. You don't say that the Quran says the punishment for zina is so and so, the Sunnah says the punishment for this is so and so. When we catch a thief, we will cut his hand. Why? Because we are following the Prophet. Is it understood? So you don't say because it is the Sunnah, it is automatically Sunnah for you to follow. There are people who came to the Prophet with their disputes. And we can't go into, not spend too much time on this. But people who would, you know, this person came and said, Prophet, I lent money to this person, he has not paid me back. So he brought the case to the Prophet. Prophet asked him, the amount he gave you, is it something you can forgive? Because he seems to be having difficulty. The man thought for a while and says, yes, I can forgive. He says, I think it would be good if you forgive. He says, no problem. So he forgave. You don't pick that hadith and tell people, you can borrow money from an Islamic bank or anybody. And if you're finding difficulty, sorry, the sunnah was to forgive. So you too, you have to forgive. Okay. The Prophet did not like his family members living a life of luxury. So he discouraged Fatima from even having somebody who would help her in the housework. He prohibited his own wives from using gold. Even though he said gold is permissible for women and silk is permissible for women but not for men. You don't pick those hadith and you start saying, oh, gold is haram. Why? The Prophet said Aisha shouldn't. So you have scholars who look at the context. What was the Prophet saying? In what capacity? Sometimes he would say things in his capacity as a mufti. Somebody comes and asks the Prophet ﷺ, is it okay for me to kiss my wife in Ramadan when I'm fasting? The Prophet said, yes. Not long after, another gentleman comes and asks the Prophet, is it okay for me to kiss my wife when I'm fasting? The Prophet said, no. Said, okay, he goes. Sahaba says, no, what happened there? Like, so is it yes or no? Like, you said yes, you said no. And the Prophet said, yeah, but the first person who came was an elderly person. You know he has more self-control. That younger one? No, I said no. Where, like a doctor, you are looking at the patient. It's not the same prescription for everybody. You have to know what was the Prophet considering. So that you don't go and say, Prophet said no for the older, yes for the younger. No, what was guiding the Prophet ﷺ when he made that type of fatwa? There are certain things the Prophet ﷺ did in his capacity as just Muhammad bin Abdullah, a messenger living in his time and place with some personal likes and personal dislikes. But not part of what anybody has to also like or dislike. And so, at one occasion, some people brought him a lizard, which they had cooked. It was like a desert lizard. And they offered it to him. He said, sorry, I don't eat that. Then another Sahabi, Khalid bin Walid, asks, is it haram? And he says, no, I'm just not used to it. Can we eat it? Yeah, go ahead. So just because the Prophet didn't want something doesn't automatically mean it is haram. Haram, you need evidence that there's a sin attached to it. Prophet liked to sleep on a mat. He had no problem with Sahaba and others who wanted to sleep on beds. And he didn't discourage them, he didn't encourage them, this is better. This is just how he preferred things. So, for scholars in this area, who have done a lot of work in trying to identify and classify the Sunnah, it becomes a warning for some of us. You don't just go and read a hadith in Bukhari or Muslim, you say it's Sahih, and you want to start jumping to conclusions about it. In what capacity did the Prophet say it? In what context? When the Prophet said, animals should be given water at night, and farmers should use the watering holes in the daytime. Is that in his capacity as a prophet, so that's what should happen for now to the Day of Judgment? Or is that in his capacity as a leader, so as to reduce friction between the pastoralists and the arable farmers? And so naturally you can see where some scholars will think this he said in his capacity as a prophet, another scholar says, no, I think it was in his capacity as a head of state. So one thing that helps the scholars is to see how did the Sahaba understand it. When the Prophet ﷺ prohibited extracting zakat on horses, you could take zakat on camel, you can take zakat on sheep, you can take zakat on this and that, but he prohibited, in a hadith in Sahih Muslim, he prohibited collecting zakat on horses. We need a plug somewhere. Umar, when he became caliph and realized that people who were dealing and renting out their horses were making far more money than people who were renting out camels, put in a new policy that zakat will be charged on horses. And so the question is, Prophet said do not collect, Umar is collecting. Who does Umar think he is? That's one way of thinking. Or Umar understood that the Prophet said this as a tax relief during a period when the Ummah needed more horses. And later on, when there were so many horses and people were making a lot of money, he expanded the pool for the benefit of the poor. And the original reason for the Prophet making his policy no more applied. Context has changed, a new policy or a new economic policy. No need for tax relief on this one. And this is why it's not enough to just say, I'm studying the Sunnah of the Prophet. You also want to understand, how did those who understand the Prophet better also understand the Sunnah? When it came to positions of these scholars, you remember we discussed these various tools that they are using, okay? These are the tools that the mujtahid is using. What you have is certain equations. You know, like in mathematics, does anybody remember BODMAS? What does it mean?
Bracket.
Bracket. Or bracket open. Division. Multiplication.
Addition and subtraction.
In other words, when somebody says to you, can you calculate this? And he says, What is 5 plus 6 minus 7 divided by 3 multiplied by 2? You don't say repeat it, and as he's saying 5 plus 3, yeah, multiplied by, divided by, this equals, no. What a mathematician does is, after you've said it, they will do what? Good, they will rearrange it. Okay, what they call the simplified equation. Anything to do with in bracket will be handled first. And division would be handled before you multiply. And multiplication will be done before you add. And addition would be, subtraction would be done last. You do not say 5 plus 3 minus 2 times this, and then you start plus and then times later. No, you do the times first, then plus, then divide. The point is, in the field of mathematics, the scholars of mathematics have come with certain ground rules for the methodology and the hierarchy of these mathematical symbols. So, division comes before multiplication, which comes before addition, which comes before subtraction. Not the other way around. So what you have actually is what they call madhabs. A madhab is a school of scholars. A madhab is not a one-man show. When you say madhab Shafi, it's not just Imam Shafi. It's Imam Shafi and Bukhari and Muslim and Imam al-Ghazali and al-Nawawi and Ibn Abdus Salam and Ibn Kathir and Ibn Hajar and scholars of Tafsir, scholars all put together. That's what is the Shafi madhab. When you say Maliki madhab, it's not just Imam Malik. It's generations of scholars that have taken to that type of equation, that methodology. So for example, in some schools of thought, let's take the Hanafi. If there is contradicting evidence, their hierarchy is to first go with the Quran. If anything contradicts the Quran, they put it aside. They go with Quran. The next highest authority is Hadith Mutawatir. Hadith that have multiple chains of narrators. Anything contradicts that comes next. The next highest authority for them is Ijma, actually Istihsan. The concern for maqasid, or the objectives of Sharia. The next important thing for them is Ijma. The next important thing for them is Qiyas. Then, Ahad, Hadith, single chain Hadith. Then they would consider Ra'i of Sahaba, usually Urf, Ra'i of Sahaba, etc. For the Maliki, highest authority, Quran. Next, Hadith Mutawatir. Anybody knows what next? Amal. They consider Amal as being similar to Hadith Mutawatir, not as strong as, but next to Amal, next to that. Then, their version of Istihsan, which they call Maslaha. Amal of Medina, for them, is Ijma. Maslaha, then they would consider Qiyas. And then they would consider Ahad Hadith. Then they would consider other tools, Urf, Sadu Zaria, etc. Shafi. Shafi won't consider highest authority Quran. The next highest, hadith mutawatir. The next highest, ijma. The next highest, hadith ahad. Then they will consider ra'ay of sahaba. And then they will consider qiyas. Hanbali, Quran, hadith mutawatir, hadith ahad, ijma, opinion of sahaba. Yes. They also consider maslaha, etc. Shafi, later on in the development of the madhab, they introduced early Shafi, the maximum ijtihad was qiyas. They didn't have sabit daraya, they didn't have maslaha, they didn't have istihsan. Okay. Shafi was very vehement against istihsan. He considered this as just conjecture. Later scholars such as Ghazali, Razi, Imam al-Juwaini introduced maslaha into the Shafi school. Early Hanbali gave istihsan a position far down. Later scholars like Ibn Taymiyyah brought modifications within the school and brought it much further in front of Ahad, a little like this school. Zahiri, Quran, Hadith or Sunnah Mutawatir, and to them Sunnah Mutawatir was as strong as Sunnah Ahad. They did not consider Ijma, they did not consider this, they only considered this where there was strong, so they really didn't prefer that. There's what they call Istishab, the presumption of continuity. You got the Ja'fari, which we usually call the Shia school. Quran, Hadith Mutawatir. They would consider Hadith Ahad they would consider Ijma of Ahl al-Bayt, opinion of Sahaba of their own, etc. These are the equations that the schools followed. What do you think they all agreed on?
Quran and Hadith Mutawatir.
They all accepted this first category. And this became the basis for Aqidah. Because if you establish Aqidah on anything else, you're going to have differences. And so for the majority of scholars, they did not use the word kufr. So this was where you could use the word kufr. Somebody rejecting something where there is certainty. Remember, these are two areas where there is certainty regarding authenticity. So where the meaning was also certain, they felt rejecting that was rejecting the core and kernel, like the heart of the deen. The reason why this is important for us as students is if you hear scholars differing, their difference usually comes from the equations they are using. Which equation are they using? So there are things they all agree on. Because the prohibition of alcohol is from the Quran, everybody agrees alcohol is haram. Okay? Because how many rakahs for subuh prayer? So many people pray subuh prayer. It's not in the Quran, but so many people pray. You have hadith mutawatir so much about how many rakahs for subuh prayer, so nobody is arguing about that. But the moment it is not in Quran and Sunnah mutawatir, you have to put your seatbelt on, you have to chill, you have to calm down. Because there's a scholar greater than you, and heaps of them too, who are going to disagree with you. Would it have been better if we only had one school of thought? Maybe if we only had Shafi, the world would be a better place. Islamic finance would collapse. All the madhabs now submit to Hanafi on Islamic finance. They're the best in Islamic finance. And it's usually because of this tool that they bring forward. So even though where I come from is Maliki, when it comes to Islamic finance, we go Hanafi. Malaysia is Shafi, but on Islamic finance, they go Hanafi. Yeah. Saudi, on Islamic finance, they go Hanafi. When it comes to the right of a woman to have a divorce, whether her husband agrees or not, everybody is going Maliki. Maliki says yes. You both have to say yes to agree to get married. And anybody who said no, it would not be a marriage, then if she wants to get out, she has the full right the way he wants to get out. And because there were cases at the time of Umar and Uthman who people wanted divorce and the husband disagreed, but Umar overrided, you know, his verdict overrode that position. When it comes to issues to do with fasting and whether an asthma patient can continue or whether you've got a drip, on many of the rules surrounding fasting, it's Shafi everybody is going with. In issues to do with the rights of a wife in marriage, the wife wants in her marital contract that she will be paid this amount by her husband every month. That if there's a divorce, she wants half the value of this. Why? Because she is going to stop working and she's losing this amount of money because of this guy. And after X number of years, she will lose her qualification to be a doctor or an IT, whatever, whatever. And if he's to divorce her, she would be in an economically worse situation. Therefore, she would want that if he is to divorce her, he should give her this amount of compensation. For the humbly, so long as he agrees to that condition, it is binding. And so within the marriage contract, because marriage contract is meant to meet the peculiar needs of marriage couples. So here, for example, in Malaysia, normally under Shafi, a woman cannot get the automatic right for divorce. But because in your marital contract, it is there, then it has solved that problem. But if it was not in the marital contract, you have a big difficulty, even in the court, even if the judge wants it. Hajj, because of the crowd, a lot of the positions of Shafi, Maliki and Hanbali, we're going Hanbali now, Hanafi, we're going Hanbali in many areas. Actually, Hajj is an area where we mix a lot of things from various madhabs just to make it convenient. Maslaha, public interest, safety. Imam Malik had a saying that the difference of opinions among the ummah is a blessing. It's not a hadith, but Malik said it. And it's when you look at how the different equations help solve different problems. It's like the different fishing rods to catch different types of fish. At this time, for this problem, you find the Shafi have a better solution. Is that why Allah has preserved these main ones? Wallahu alam. But critical point there is to recognize this lowest, what is LCM? Lowest common multiple? Here we mean lowest certainty multiple. Something they all have in common, Quran, Sunnah, Mutawatir. And depending on your madhab, what is the next one? But please don't do takfir, don't get too worked up when scholars start to differ after that. They will always differ and they are not new differences. You may just say, I've never heard of that fatwa before. A Hanafi believes he can pray Salat without reciting Fatiha and his prayer is fine. Why? Because Allah says in the Quran, فَقْرَوْ مَا تَيَسَّرُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ, recite whatever you find easy from the Quran. So even though there's an Ahad hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said you should recite Fatiha, in fact another one he says there's no Salat without Fatiha, because it is an Ahad hadith, it's not enough to qualify the Quran in the Hanafi equations. And so when somebody embraces Islam and they are finding it difficult to pray, you may find that's an easier one for them to follow, because they have not yet memorized Fatiha. With all these equations, they have certain ground rules. They're like traffic rules. So if you look at ijtihad and usul al-fiqh as developing the rules for driving a car, you have certain major traffic rules for the mufti when giving fatwas. Five major ones. We'll not go into them in detail, but one of them is that al-umur bi maqasidiha, actions are judged by the intentions behind them. That maqasid must be considered. So this person kills another somebody, this one kills another person. For us it's killing and it's killing. But when we find that this was intentional and this was accidental, the punishment differs. Yeah. So it's not just it was killed, what happened on the outside, you're also interested in what's the intention. That certainty is not overruled by doubt. That harm must be eliminated. That necessity allows the relaxation of laws, and that custom is a basis for legal judgment. These are the five qawaid. These are the five major traffic rules that guide people who are doing ijtihad or giving fatwa. One of them, which says certainty is not overruled by doubt, comes up with another rubric, another sub-qaida, which is that al-asl fil asha al-ibaha, that the basic premise in things is permissibility. Okay, the default fatwa on everything in mu'amalat in particular is halal, ibaha, mubah. Okay, the default fatwa on things is that of permissibility. And they reach this conclusion, and this is an important one, they reach this conclusion based on many verses of the Quran and hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Verses of the Quran where Allah says, He has created everything for your benefit. Hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said, those things that Allah has made compulsory upon you, keep to them. Those things He has prohibited, keep away from them. Those things He is silent about, are not out of forgetfulness, but rahmatan lakum, out of mercy to you. So don't inquire into them. In another version of the hadith, whatever there is silence over is forgiven. So based on this, and there are many other hadith and actions that make the scholars conclude, that in mu'amalat, social affairs, what you call dunya issues, worldly, mundane issues, as opposed to deen, religious, prescribed worship and devotion. So this is your social interactions, etc. As opposed to ibadat, which refers to devotional acts. Or worship, etc., like your prayers and your nafila and this and that. The general rule in mu'amalat is that everything is permissible except what is prohibited. For a thing to be prohibited, you need certainty, a level of certainty based on authenticity. Meaning and implication, and the first port of call is Quran. If the Quran says something is haram, then it is haram. If the Quran is silent about it, eating a particular type of food like kangaroo is mu'amalat. Everything is halal except what is haram. For you to say kangaroo meat is haram, you need certainty in authenticity and clear meaning that it is haram. And that should come firstly from the Quran. If the Quran says it is haram and you've got something from the Quran, then it will be haram. If the Quran is silent about kangaroos, the next highest authority is what? Sorry? Sunnah Mutawatir. If Sunnah Mutawatir says something is haram, consensus among the scholars, consensus among the schools of thought, it is haram. If Sunnah Mutawatir is silent about it, then they are ready to look elsewhere. Such as Sunnah Ahad, single chain hadith, or no more than three hadith. But this is where things start to get divided. If it is here, there's divided opinions. Shafi and Hanbali say it is haram. Hanafi say it is makruh tahrimi, not haram, a lower form. Maliki divided into two. Some say it is makruh because it's authentic and no contradictory evidence. Others say because it is not supported by Amal of Medina, it is Shaz and therefore Mubah. If there's nothing here, then you move on. And here you're looking at the other tools of Ijtihad. Ijma, Qiyas, etc. And if nothing in this makes it prohibitive, then the default judgment goes back to halal. So in mu'amalat, it is not the person saying it is halal that needs evidence. Everything has been created for you. It's the person saying it's haram that needs to provide evidence. Are we okay with that? What is the evidence that the voice of a woman is not part of her aura? Anybody? What is the evidence that a woman can speak in public? Sorry?
There's a woman singing in a wedding time of Rasulullah.
Okay. But somebody will say, okay, that's just wedding.
Rasulullah asked a woman to sing after a walk, steam on the camel.
Okay, so you had some women who sang, okay, that's after war. No war now.
The question should be the other way around.
What do you mean?
I mean, what's the evidence that a woman's voice is haram instead of...
Is the thinking understood? I think somebody was saying something similar. The default ruling is halal. It's the person who is saying the voice of a woman is haram to be heard that should bring the evidence. Are we clear about that?
Okay.
Yeah. The default ruling is it is halal. If the person saying her voice is aura, a woman should not speak in public, you bring the evidence. Okay. There's no hadith where the Prophet said the voice of a woman is part of her aura. It's just, you know, people, you hear it again and again until you start believing there's probably some hadith to that effect. You read books of women calling adhan. Aisha called Adhan. That's why in the Malik, in the Hanafi and the Shafi'i Madhab, even the Hanbali, a woman can call Adhan. Find in Fiqh Sunnah that a woman can even do an ikamah for a men's prayer. She just doesn't leave the prayer. When... Anyway. So, please remember this. When it comes to ibadah, difference of opinion. For some scholars, in ibadah, they treat it the same way. And that's why they allow maulud and nabi and dhikr after prayer. For others, ibadah has the opposite. Everything is haram, except what is halal, if you have evidence that it is halal. And then it will go through the same. And to these scholars, if you come up with anything in ibadah or aqidah without the necessary proof, it is called bid'ah, an innovation. So people like Al-Izz bin Abdus Salam, Imam As-Suyuti, would apply this principle to both mu'amalat and ibadah. Other scholars would differ with them on that.
To ask that. But the scholars who opinion is ibadah, everything is permissible, except there's a dalil not permissible. What's the other hujjah or the argument about it?
Another day. I'm just looking at time. There's difference of opinion among the Sahaba. Also because in the hadith on bid'ah, most of what the Prophet said was condemning bid'ah. So they viewed bid'ah as always bad. But because people like Umar described the new tradition of praying Taraweeh in congregation, which he started as a continuous thing, as a good bid'ah, you have those who, like Imam Shafi and a number of others, who said that bid'ah can be good and can be bad. Just a sunnah can be good sunnah or bad sunnah. It's a bit more complicated than that, much more. Sorry, we'll jump. Yeah, we're getting to the place where... Anyway, urf, imitation, we've discussed this already. Custom, you can imitate people in their custom if it is not in something that contradicts the Sharia. Okay, and you have to be distinguished between imitating people in something that identifies them with their aqidah, like wearing a crucifix, okay, or dressing in a way that identifies you as a Christian or as a monk, from dressing that just identifies you as a native or a Westerner or an Easterner or a Chinese. This is all your urf. So always remember, it goes back to this one. In custom, you ask yourself, is it mu'amalat? If it is, everything halal except what is haram, etc. So, we won't say more on that. Flowcharts we've already done. Seatbelts. Where do you think you have to wear your seatbelt and not get too excited on this subject area? Anybody? Yeah, where do differences begin?
After Sunnah Mutawatir.
After Sunnah Mutawatir.